Welcome. I'd like to get started because there's a lot of exciting presentations this evening. This is one of the, I think, nicest celebrations of science in the schools in Falmouth because we have the pleasure of having four very talented young scientists presenting their science fair projects, two from Falmouth Academy and two from Falmouth High School. And the first speaker this evening has been up here giving a presentation now for 3 years in a row. Adam Rago won the first prize at Falmouth High School, and he has a totally different project than he had last year. So he's a very versatile young scientist. His project was on the design and analysis of a motor vehicle event data recorder, a black box that I think he put in the trunk of a car. And for this project, he won the Mary Sears Scholarship Award from the Woodsull Oceanographic Institution, a cash prize from Associates of Cape Cod, gift certificates from the Hui Exhibit Center, and when Adam is not thinking about science projects, he is, I know, a very good basketball player and team captain of the Falmouth High School basketball team, as well as a member of the National Honor Society. So Adam, welcome to the podium again.
Thank you all for coming tonight. Can you hear me? Yeah. I'd like to tell you about my project this year entitled Design and Analysis of a Motor Vehicle Event Data Recorder. And before I start talking about what I actually did, I'd like to start by giving a little background on what is an event data recorder. I'm sure everyone's heard of the black box that's recovered from an airplane. The flight data recorder and the cockpit voice recorder after an unfortunate crash. These black boxes, as they're called, have also made their way into the automobile. They measure various characteristics of the driving task both before and after a collision. On this machine, this is an example of one data recorder in a General Motors car. And data is collected on a running loop and is saved before and after an airbag deployment event. Or it is also saved in what's called a near deployment event, where the airbag accelerometers are activated, but the crash isn't significant enough to deploy the airbag. Event data recorders measure characteristics. This table at the bottom is an example of several of the important characteristics measured by event data recorders, the most valuable being in vehicle speed, acceleration at the time of the crash, the status of the airbag, steering torque, and it measures a wide range of characteristics of the vehicle, from vehicle speed to other things such as status of the diagnostic lights or even the status of the seatbelt light for the driver and passenger. These have applicability in many fields. This information is primarily used to reconstruct accident scenes by law enforcement personnel and by insurance agents and agencies. But it can also be used to analyze the performance of a car or improve highway design. Data from these machines can be used, for example, to determine how much a curve should be banked or the strategic placement of guardrails and signs. In the late 1990s, these designs became more accurate. In the model year 2000, General Motors added an event data recorder to every one of their vehicles, and Ford and Toyota are currently developing similar models. Shown at the right is a graphic of the applicability of one event data recorder. As you can see, it's about a four-inch cube, and it can be used anywhere from a space shuttle to a race car or an airplane. The purpose of my project was to analyze driving characteristics of various vehicle operators using a motor vehicle event data recorder. I'm looking to determine if the machine can tell the difference between various drivers and various automobiles. The first phase of the experiment was to actually design a motor vehicle event data recorder, using vernier motion sensors obtained from Falmouth High School. And then the second part was to test it in the field over a driving course with different vehicles and different drivers. What you see on the screen and what you see down here is the final product after a largely trial and error first part of the experiment. There's four main sensors. First one up here is an accelerometer, which will measure acceleration in the forward direction and deceleration in the reverse direction. A second force sensor measures vertical vibrations due to bumps in the road. The third main sensor is a turning force sensor, which will measure turns to the side from side to side for left and right turns. This machine was placed in the trunk of the car facing this way. And there's also a fourth sensor that was used, an event logger. This machine was used, this sensor, a button was pressed every time I went through a turn, a stop, or a large acceleration, and will come in handy later in terms of determining where the vehicle is within a test. The information from these four sensors is logged into a Vernier Lab Pro, basically a data logging unit associated with these four sensors. The data is then in turn logged to the computer through a USB cable where it can be exported and analyzed. After several trial and error tests of just driving around to determine if the machine would work, I set up a standard course at Falmouth High School to determine if this machine could in fact log driving events and differentiate between different drivers. This is an overview of the course. A lot of it took place in the student parking lot here, several spins in the drop-off circles in front of our school, and then turns onto Gifford Street. I'll go into more detail in just a minute. This is the graphic of the first part of the events 1 through 14, and it took place in, as I said, the student parking lot of our school. Each time I went through an event, as I'll show here, the button was pressed. It starts out with 2/10-of-a-mile loops within the parking lot, making left turns. Then 3 left turns at events 4, 5, and 6, out of the row and then back into the same row. What it then moves to with events 7, 8, and 9, and 10, 11, and 12 is very tight turning circles. I call it a left and right spin with about a 4.5 meter radius. The large circles, loops, were then repeated at a 1/10 of a mile while making right turns. At this point, I turned out of the student parking lot at event 15 and into our front drop-off circles, making 2 spins using left turns at events 16 through 17 and 19 through 20. Event 21 is then a turn out onto Gifford Street. The course followed then for about a little over a mile, and it ended thereafter. There are a total of 25 events, and each time I went through an event, as I said, this button was hit to divide the course into a series of events that could later be analyzed. The two vehicles that were used were a 1997 Toyota Camry, shown at the top, and a 2000 Honda Odyssey. To get a little bit into how the data was collected, this is an example of a short turn. I believe it's actually a tight spin. And this is what the raw data looks like when it comes into the computer. To remove a lot of these small, high-frequency vibrations, the data was smooth using a 25-point moving average. This average was then changed in future tests to a 12-point moving average when less data was sampled. The information is then separated into events through the event logger and placed into a pivot table where various statistics are calculated, among them mean, standard deviation, minimums and maximums, and as well as other statistics. One final step taken in the method of data analysis was to take cumulative measurements on left turns and right turns. Oftentimes, due to uncertainty in the sensor, there's a small amount in between, right around the axis, that has small vibrations or oscillations that weren't actually a turn, an acceleration, or a deceleration. Therefore, cumulative measurements were taken above and below a certain value that I made up myself, isolating left turns and right turns, or acceleration and deceleration. There was also a problem with this sensor, measuring vibrations. Something happened when I was calibrating it, and it was turning out values that were far greater than you would expect in a normal vibration in the driving task. This was therefore standardized by subtracting the mean and dividing by the standard deviation. This effectively made it easier to analyze in the end. There are four tests that were performed on the course that I described before. Myself and my dad, Paul Rago, were the test drivers for this experiment. The Honda Odyssey was driven through the course, and then the Toyota Camry three times by various drivers. The final test done with the Toyota Camry was one in which I drove more conservatively than my typical driving style. Tried to turn less hard and brake less hard as well. This is an example of what the data looks like when it comes into the computer. The test took place over about 720 seconds. And as you can see here, the blue is an example of acceleration. Any acceleration is shown as a peak above the graph. Decelerations or braking is a peak below the graph. The same with left turns and right turns. A right turn is anything above the axis, and a left turn below the axis. But just looking at this graph, it's kind of difficult to see where the car was in position over the course. To break the data off into smaller bits, the first part highlighted here came from the left turns in the longer spins and left turns out of the parking lot. The second part came from the tighter spins. And as you can see, a left spin has a large peak and a long peak below the axis of the graph. And finally, the spins in the opposite direction are shown by this part of the graph, events 12 to 15. Continuing, the highlighted portion is then the spins within our drop-off circles at Falmouth High School. And the final highlighted portion is another set of spins and then travel on Gifford Street. The portion that's not highlighted here is more or less a straight travel, and as you can see, there aren't many turns within this portion until the end when we turned off the road. This is another example of myself driving the Toyota Camry at a very slow manner. In comparison with the previous tests, for example, the accelerations were far less, and the turns were also not as great. I'll summarize this data in one final graph in a minute. As I said, the vibrations data was fairly inaccurate due to errors in the sensor. Therefore, it was analyzed separate from the acceleration and turning data. The red highlighted portion is part from the FHS parking lot, and the green and blue on the street. As I hope you can kind of see, there are more vibrations, more bumps and potholes on roads that are more traveled by a greater amount of vehicles. This table here is a summary of the data from the four tests that were performed, with the blue being myself driving the Toyota Camry, the red being myself driving very slowly, the green being my dad driving the Honda Odyssey, and the red, my dad driving the Toyota Camry. And as you can see, for the most part, the blue bars are greater than all the other bars, showing I'm typically a more aggressive driver than the other tests. And as you can also see, the driving recorder, data recorder, can differentiate between a typical test and one that's more conservative, as the turning force, acceleration and deceleration are all substantially less than the other bars on the graph. There are a few sources of uncertainty in this project that could lead to future data improvements, and also some that I tried to correct within my study. The first one was electronic noise from the sensor and also environmental conditions. For example, the idling of the car will create a small vibration. The second problem is also some harmonic oscillations within the design. These four sensors only actually go out to about here in the actual sensor. Therefore, I added a long metal piece to increase the amount of force caused by a driving event. Unfortunately, for example, when you hit a vibration, it vibrates up and down for a bit longer portion. And the addition of that bar added some uncertainty. There are also errors associated with sensor tilt. For example, the accelerometer measures acceleration and deceleration, but it relies on a silicone chip inside. The problem with this is, for example, if you were on a huge hill, something like this, it would measure a deceleration in this direction. To go back a little bit to the first point, electronic noise, I undertook a process to try to correct for this, to try to remove some of this through a statistical method. And I call this process decomposition of the signal. In this process, the smooth standardized data was imported into a spreadsheet. And this data was then subtracted from the raw data, leaving a group of high-frequency oscillations that were originally removed by the simple smoothing. This was then averaged with a smaller moving average, approximately 5 points. And then that, in turn, 5-point moving average was subtracted from this data, the first residual. What that whole process effectively left was this graph, a group of high-frequency oscillations that I determined to be fairly close to representative of electronic noise. This is an example of one graph of signal decomposition. The blue line you see here is acceleration over the same test, the red line being the first residual of noise, and the yellow line being the second residual. The process wasn't entirely effective, but as you can see from this graph, there's a small group of high-frequency noise that is skewing the data somewhat. To make some overall conclusions, I feel that the motor vehicle event data recorder was successfully designed and tested in the field in the four principal tests. And the results suggest that the data recorder is capable of logging driving events in real time and differentiating between different vehicles and different driving styles. To talk about some possible data improvements, one thing I'd like to do is interface this machine with the electronic systems of the car, measuring such factors as speed, engine revolution per minute, to try to make it more like the commercial data recorder you saw before. My analysis of position was done in the time aspect. It would be interesting to see what it would be, hopefully similar, in space, analyzing this using a global positioning system. And finally, and I think as always, a more accurate set of sensors and more powerful data collection would improve results. Finally, I'd like to thank a couple of people who have helped me make this project successful. My parents, Paul Rago and Nancy Rago, for all their invaluable help, and Dr. Hinkle at the high school for loaning the use of these sensors. That's all I have to say. Can I answer any questions? Or?
Giacomelli, who is a junior from Falmouth Academy, and Joe won his project investigating the circadian rhythm of the bioluminescent bacteria Vibrio fischeri. For his project, he won an award from McLean Research Laboratories. He also won the second place award from the Northeast Branch of the American Society for Microbiologists at the South Shore Regional Science Fair, and he will attend the State Science Fair on May 3rd. Joe is a member of the Falmouth Academy varsity soccer team. He's also a member of the National Honor Society, and he also enjoys other sports and activities. So as soon as Joe is wired up, he will share with us the results of his project.
Cycle because it's more conducive to its life processes to have more emission during light emission during the night than during the day. I also thought that it might have a circadian rhythm because it's just a more efficient process. And I'll start off with some background about phylogenetics in general and the bacteria itself. Phylogenetics is defined as the emission of light by living creatures. And chemiluminescence, which is what I measured specifically, is the emission of light by living creatures through chemical means. And in all these phytoluminescent organisms, light is given off by the reaction of luciferin with the enzyme luciferase. And luciferin is a type of protein, and luciferase is an enzyme. And there's a direct conversion in this process, so the product is put in a higher energy state. And that's known as cold light because it's a very direct process. And in an incandescent bulb, for example, a lot of light is wasted as heat, but in this, it's much more direct and thus efficient. There are many forms of interaction between the different kind of bioluminescent creatures, but in all cases, it's characterized by the oxidation of luciferin by luciferase, and the different way that the chemicals interact accounts for different intensities and color of light. And in some cases, such as a firefly that you might commonly see, there's a flash of light. And in other cases, such as the bacteria I measured, there's a constant glow. And the color of the light ranges from greenish to blue. And in the Vibrio fishery, the light given off is blue, but in some cases, it can even be yellow or red. And Vibrio fishery, which I did my project on, is an aerobic marine bacteria. It emits light through luciferin and luciferase, and it lives in cool marine habitats in coastal areas, and its Vibrio fishery, the bacteria has been documented to take part in symbiotic relationships, such as the one with the inch-long squid, Euphrema scalopes. In this relationship, both organisms gain some advantage. The shrimp lives in about mid-level surface in the ocean, and it has an organ on its underbelly that attracts bacteria, and the bacteria enter this organ, and the bacteria on its underside gives off light, which makes it hard for predators looking up at the bacteria, up at the squid, to make out silhouette between the night sky and the squid itself. And there's a certain mucus in the organism of the squid that goes up other bacteria besides Vibrio fishery. And what the bacteria gets from this is a favorable environment inside the organ and nutrients. Part of why I tested the circadian rhythm of the bacteria was to try to determine if the Vibrio fishery had a function for luminescence outside of these circadian relationships. In some cases, some scientists think that the luminescence is just a byproduct of metabolism, and I thought that if I could prove they had a circadian rhythm, I could indicate that it would have to have a function outside of symbiotic relationships, because if it regulates the amount of light given off through some sort of auto-inducer or activator or inhibitor, then it would doing so for some particular function, whereas if it was byproduct of metabolism, it might also oscillate, but it might not be as clearly defined. And circadian rhythm is known as a 24-hour oscillation in nerve activity, body temperature, or some sort of life process. And circadian rhythms are present in humans, but they're also present in unicellular protists and similar organisms. This is the reaction that gives off light in vivo fissure. This is all the oxygen here is necessary for the reaction to take place, and that reacts with the first substrate to make an intermediate structure, and that in turn reacts with the second substrate to make, and in that second part of the equation, certain bonds are broken, and that results in the formation of hydroxyphlavin in its excited state, and that gives off photons or light, which is one of the products. And I hypothesized that Weber Fisher had a circadian rhythm, so to test this, I used a setup that had five groups of five plates of Weber Fisher. I inoculated them over a 12-hour period every 3 hours, and I measured them also every 3 hours, starting 9 hours from the inoculation of each group. And this chart illustrates the various inoculation and measurement times. You can see how I inoculated the five groups of five plates of bacteria, starting at 3 on the afternoon of Friday, and I had 5 inoculation times, and this was the measurement of the first group, which was 9 hours from its inoculation, and I started each group 9 hours, so that eventually there were 5 groups, and I continued 5 readings of 5 groups until it had been 33 hours from the inoculation of the first group. And how I measured the light emission was I used this STOA LI light sensing instrument, which I borrowed from lots of computers. It measures light intensity as low as 0.01 logarithmic lumens per square foot. And how I measured it was I placed it above each one of the 25 plates and left it there for 25 seconds. I wrapped it in tinfoil. And the purpose of the tinfoil was to reflect the light around, because in some cases the light was only around the perimeter of the plate because of there's more oxygen present inside. So oxygen and circular reaction take place, so that's where there's more light typically. And I wrapped it in tin foil and moved it from plate to plate along this pattern that I had set up with all the 25 plates. And you can see the 5 groups of 5 plates, and I placed the instrument above each one of the plates, and so the process took about half an hour, and I moved over all the plates and measured the light emission. And afterwards I plugged it into my computer, and I was able to print out the data in the form of graphs and readings, which the instrument takes every 2 seconds. And you could, on the graphs, you could see the plane, which was the room darkness of the room, which I tried to make as dark as possible, and jumps of light, which was the luminescence of each plate. And I matched the time of each spike in the graph with the time in the data readout to find the numerical value, which I averaged to find this graph. And as you can see, the data largely supported my hypothesis. I thought that there would be two trends which might take place to indicate the presence of circadian rhythm. The first one was that if the bacteria lived for more than one cycle, that if they had two peaks and they correlated with day and night cycles outside while they were still in darkness, that would indicate a circadian rhythm. And the second trend was that since I scattered my inoculation times, one every 3 hours, I thought that if the groups that were inoculated later leave at the same time as the groups that were inoculated sooner, the trend might be in order to compensate for a circadian rhythm, so that they would all peak during the nighttime, which would be favorable for whatever light function luminescence gives them if it is an advantage. And as you can see here, the first group, the first three groups had 6-hour plateaus of high light luminescence, and whereas the last two groups went up very dramatically, as in the first groups, but had dramatic drop-off right after their peak. And I attributed this to circadian rhythm. The first groups had longer plateaus, whereas the last two groups may have decreased faster, because the first groups had time to reach high enough concentration on the plate to give off enough light to have enough concentration on the plate to be able to give off light, whereas the last groups may have not had enough time to do that, so they peaked a tiny bit later, even though they compensated for the circadian rhythm. And the main trend that I was able to observe was that the time it took for the groups to peak from their inoculation decreased with the later inoculation group, You can see that the first group had a significant lull that lasted 6 hours before it went up. And this period here was 18 hours from the inoculation of the first group. So it took the first group 18 hours to peak from when it was inoculated. The second group took 15 hours, the third group took 12. And the last two groups had high light emission only 9 hours after they were inoculated. And you can see that later groups took a shorter time and attributed that to circadian rhythms. And one last trend was that all of the light readings dropped very significantly, 27 hours from the inoculation of the first group, and that corresponded to daylight outside. And I thought that with the advent of daylight outside, the luminescence might have dropped because bacteria giving off light during the day might not be as conducive to its life functions as it would if it was giving off light during the night. And as you can see here, there's a small increase in luminescence for the last two groups. I really wasn't sure why that happened. I thought that since only the last two groups went up, they still may have had enough resources on the plate to have a smaller peak, but I'm really not sure why that happened. And circadian rhythms, which is what I was looking for, can be either endogenous or they can be a reaction to outside conditions. And my data really doesn't allow me to say whether it was endogenous or not, because the bacteria was outside of its natural environment. But since it had a circadian rhythm despite being in the darkness, that seemed to indicate that it took place during the dark, that it was endogenous, sorry. Here are the main points of my analysis that I've just gone through. And you can see the different scattered grouping hour times that I mentioned here. And some errors that I could think of in my process was the instrument here only measured to the tenths place of lumens per square foot. I would have liked it to be accurate enough to measure to the thousandths, 0.001 lumens per square foot. And also there may have been some error in the inoculation process. How I did it was I had one plate from the biological supply with visible starved bacteria on it, and I used a loop to take an 8 millimeter long stripe off of the one plate, and I suspended it in water and then used micropipette to distribute an equal amount to each plate. And the 8 millimeter long stripes, they may have been different thickness because it was a little uneven. So if there had been more or less bacteria in each in each water or in each plate, they may have had more time to reach, well, not more time, but they may have been more bacteria, so they could have peaked sooner. And another possible error was that the loop that I used to take the stripes off, I cooled it by putting it into the auger, but it may have not have had enough time to cool, so it may have still killed some bacteria because it was hot and being suspected. And in future research, I would like to monitor O2 consumption along with circadian rhythm to see if, because O2 is a good indicator of metabolism, I could correlate that with the circadian rhythm to see if possibly to decide whether it was endogenous or not. And my conclusion overall was that, as I hypothesized, the groups of beaver fishery that were inoculated later took a shorter time to peak than the groups that were inoculated sooner. And I attribute that to the presence of circadian rhythm. That's what I have to say. Any questions?
Thank you. Our next speaker is Paul Heslinger, who won the Tupp Prize at Falmouth Academy for his investigation of the effect of camber on wing performance in airplanes. For this project, he won the A. Lawrence Pearson III scholarship from the Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution. And Paul is also a lacrosse and basketball player, as well as a scuba diver and snowboarder. So without further ado, Paul, as soon as you get wired up. And Paul is just a freshman.
Once again, my project was the effect of camber on wing performance. I just want to go through a little background how I determined how to get this project. When I was in seventh grade, I went down and I visited my aunt down in Maryland. And She works at the David Taylor Research Center, and I was able to see the wind tunnels that she performed her tests in. I thought that was really cool. I got to see all the different fans and everything, and some of the fans were about 15 feet in diameter. So when I was that small, that was a pretty big fan. And ever since I got to see those wind tunnels, I've always been interested in the subject. And finally, this year, I got to conduct an experiment with a wind tunnel, and I chose the effect of camber on wing performance. The purpose of my project was to determine the effects of camber on the lift and drag of a low aspect ratio wing. Low aspect ratio means that the wing is short and stubby, instead of a high aspect ratio, which means the wing is long and thin. I hypothesized that the wing with the largest camber would achieve the greatest lift, and that the drag of all three wings would be similar because each wing had the same thickness. A couple of places where low aspect ratio wings occur are wing and ground effect vehicles, marine propellers, gas-powered turbines, micro-air vehicles, new attack submarines, and hydrofoils. Because my project has quite a bit of terminology, I want to go over a little bit of it right now. First and foremost, this is a cross-section of a wing. The furthest point forward on the wing is called the leading edge. And the opposite, the point furthest back, is the trailing edge. This solid black line here is the upper surface, and the corresponding lower line is the lower surface. The chord is the shortest distance between the leading and trailing edge, shown with that solid black line there. And the mean camber line is equidistant from both the upper and lower surface of the wing. It's shown with the dotted line here. Thickness is described as the greatest distance between the upper and lower surface of the wing. And camber is the distance between the mean camber line and the chord line. For my project, I used this wind tunnel here. The contraction section where the wind is taken in is here. Here, the clear plexiglass area is the test section. This wooden area is the diffuser section. And this metal piece is the attic fan that I used to power my wind tunnel. The maximum speed in the test section that I recorded in my wind tunnel was about 31 miles per hour. First and foremost in my project, I needed to determine the variation of the speed in the test section. So I constructed an apparatus of a pedostatic tube and a manometer. Basically what it does is it measures the different pressures and then displays the speed in meters per second and the pressure in inches of water. And I plotted my data here in the variation of speed in the test sections in the distance from the sidewall versus the speed in meters per second. The graph shows that as I recorded data further from the wall or closer to the tunnel center line, the speed of the wind actually decreased. This was due to me using a circular power fan so that as the fan spun, the tips were moving at a faster speed than the edge of the fan closest to the axle. Therefore, the wind was moving out of the wind tunnel faster near the edges rather than faster near the center. For my project, I needed to create three wings. The first wing I created was a symmetrical wing, so it didn't have any camber because there was no distance between the upper and lower surface other than the chord line. I then increased the camber to 1.5%, and I've created one last wing with a 3% increased camber. There's a little bit of terminology I want to go over once again. Lift is the force perpendicular to the relative wind. So if the wind is blowing like this, the lift would be perpendicular, pulling the wing upward. Angle of attack is the angle at which the wing makes with the relative wind. So once again, if the wind was blowing like this, the angle of attack would be this angle right here. You could have a negative angle of attack if the wing was dipping, or a positive angle of attack if the wing was rising. Lift coefficient is a non-dimensional parameter, which basically means it doesn't have units. Aerodynamicists like to use non-dimensional parameters so that they can use those, they can achieve certain lifts for different size models. They can scale different models to outfit the same or similar lift. Here, the 3% cambered airfoil is shown in the blue, the 1.5 in green, and the no cambered wing in black. Stalling occurs when the wing no longer achieves a greater amount of lift for an increasing angle of attack. This graph here, my lift performance graph, shows the basic discoveries of my project. It's plotted angle of attack versus lift coefficient. It shows that the wing with the greatest camber achieved the greatest lift. It shows also that as the camber is increased, the stall is delayed, yet when it occurs, it's much more abrupt, so that as the camber is increased, after the wing stalls, the decrease in lift is much greater. Also, this plot shows that for a given lift coefficient, say 0.6, if you run your finger along and then drop down, it's at about 1 degree angle of attack. And then if you keep continuing to the symmetrical airfoil and run your finger down, it's at 4 degrees angle of attack. So a 3% increase in camber is equivalent to a 3-degree angle of attack change, or a 1% increase in angle of attack is equivalent to a 1% camber increase. Next, I measured the drag of all three wings. Drag is the force parallel to the relative wind. So if the wind was blowing like this, the drag would hold the wing back from moving forward. Here, the angle of attack is plotted versus the drag coefficient. Drag coefficient, similar to lift coefficient, is a non-dimensional parameter. Once again, the no cambered airfoil is represented in black, the 1.5 in green, and the 3% in blue. All three wings had a similar drag pattern for my experiments, except from about 10 degrees to 15 degrees. I believe this to have occurred because of the different stalling patterns as shown previously in my lift performance graph. I summed up a couple of key points in my analysis, such as the maximum variation of the speed in the test section was about 2.9%. A 1% increase in camber is approximately equivalent to a 1 degree increase in angle of attack. As the camber increases, the stall is delayed, yet when it occurs, it's much more abrupt. And the 1.5 and 3% cambered airfoils were more efficient than the symmetric wing. In conclusion, the hypothesis was fully supported. It was determined that the wing with the largest camber achieved the greatest lift, and the drag was similar for each wing. After I completed my experiment, I wanted to learn a little bit more about the flow over the top of the wing. So I attached short pieces of string to a piece of tape and then to the top of my 3% cambered airfoil. I then placed it in the wind tunnel and turned it on. Here at 14 degrees angle of attack, all of the yarn tufts are flowing straight towards the back of the wing because the wind is going this way. It shows that the flow is attached and that it's not moving the yarn tufts at all. But then a 1 degree angle of attack change completely changes the flow pattern of all the yarn tufts. This correlates to the stall pattern of the 3% cambered airfoil. You can see that there's no pattern to where the yarn tufts flow. It's chaotic. It really just kind of flows all over. I was able to observe this and then take pictures of this. Next, I created a viscous substance of oil so that I could paint it over the top of the wing and then turn on the wind tunnel and have it not fly off. After creating the substance, I evenly coated the top of the wing and turned on the wind tunnel. The area where the oil remains up near the top and down here at the bottom is where the flow is detached, and where the oil no longer remains near the center and on the sides is where the flow is attached. So basically what happened at 12 degrees angle of attack, the flow went over the top of the wing, then attached to the back, and then detached once again at the bottom of the wing. Then at 20 degrees angle of attack, the wing is experiencing stall, and what is actually happening is the air is reversing and coming up the back of the wing. This then splits and spirals in a motion here, creating what looks like a cross-section of a mushroom. This is called a mushroom stall cell. And that concluded my experiments. Any questions?
And the last one for this evening is Marley Bice. And Marley won a first place award for her project titled, How Well Do the Oxygen Isotopes of Planktonic Foraminifera Reflect Climate Trends Off the Coast of Woods Hole? For her project, Marley won a $500 National Marine Fisheries Service Young Scientist Award, a first place award from the Salt Pond Area Bird Sanctuaries, a scholarship from the Sea Education Association, and a savings bond from the Cooperative Institute for Climate and Ocean Research at HUI. Marley also captured her first place award at the South Shore Regional Science Fair. And she is a member of the Falmouth High School Marching Band, the All Cape Band, and the National Honor Society, and the Music Honor Society. So Marley, as soon as you're wired, both for PowerPoint and for sound, you may begin.
Working? Okay. So, you'll have to excuse my voice. I lost my voice a couple of days ago. So, good evening, everyone. Before I begin my presentation, I would like to thank several scientists at Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution for their time and assistance in making this project successful. First of all, I'd like to thank my project advisor, Lloyd Cagran. He's right over there. And I'd also like to thank Al Gagnon and all of the scientists at the NOSAMS facility. Steve Manganini, Julie Palmieri, Kathy Elder, Nancy Copley, and Ruth Curry, who all helped in some way, so thank you to all of them. There are several questions or topics that were addressed in this project. I had to ask myself, what are planktonic foraminifera? What is Delta 18-0 and what does it mean? What are the variables? What is the mock nest? And finally, what were my results and what do they mean? This is a picture of a live planktonic foraminifera. When alive, these fragile spines are characteristic of planktonic foraminifera. Now, this is what the same species of forum would look like after it had died and fallen to the seafloor. Although my forums were alive when collected, they had been dead for 20 years by the time I got to them, so they looked just like a forum that had fallen to the bottom of the oceans. Forums are marine protozoa, which secrete a calcium carbonate skeleton in equilibrium with the temperature and salinity values of the oceans they were living in. Delta 18O is the abbreviation for the difference between the abundances of the oxygen isotopes, oxygen 16 and oxygen 18. My Delta 18O data was found using the mass spectrometer at the AMS facility in Hui. The forums, which are essentially calcium carbonate, are dropped into phosphoric acid so that carbon dioxide gas was given off. The mass spectrometer can then find the amount of each isotope in the sample because it can tell a difference between the different weights of the molecules. The relationship between Delta 18O and the temperature is shown in this graph of the equilibrium precipitation equation line for calcium carbonate. In general, the lower the Delta 18O, the higher the temperature recorded in the forum. Scientists are able to find the past ocean temperatures by taking core samples from the bottom of the oceans and studying the Delta 18O data found in the forum skeletons. It is true you can get temperature from forums from core samples, but you don't know what season or what depth the forums are living in. Therefore, it cannot be proven from the core sample data that they are indeed good recorders of temperature. However, by taking forums that were collected using plankton toes, you know exactly what month they were collected in. You also know approximately what depth they were sampled in. You also know the temperature of the oceans they were living in, so you can directly compare the temperature recorded in the forum to the actual temperature of the oceans. Scientists are also unsure about which species of forums are the best indicators of sea surface temperature. My forums are collected using the Mach Nest system. Mach Nest is an acronym for Multiple Opening Closing Net and Environmental Sensing System. Mach Nest is special because it can open and close nets to sample at specific depths in the water column. This is another picture of the Mach Nest. This picture, it is being pulled back onto the ship. This is an exaggerated example of a slide of forums. After sieving the sample, I would put each sieve under a microscope and pick the individual forums using a tiny paintbrush. I would then sort the forums by species as illustrated in the slide. This is a graph of the Delta 18O data versus temperature. The dashed line is the equilibrium precipitation equation line that I showed you before. Each column of data points represents a different month of data. Initially, I wanted to find the entire annual temperature cycle, but due to poor preservation on the part of several of the samples, I was left with only 6 samples that I could get data from. Even so, there are several important things to notice about this graph. The black squares represent the species G. inflata, which was present in every sample. And although inflata gives you data points that are close to the equation line in the winter months, it gives you data that is much lower than the equation line in the warmer months. This is consistent with the fact that G. inflata is a cold water species, so it would be living in colder, deeper waters in the warmer months, and therefore giving me a lower Delta 18O value. The red cross and the pink square represent the species G. sucullifer and G. rubra pink, respectively. And these species gave me data points that were very close or right on the equation line. So therefore, I can conclude that forums do record temperature, and G. sucullifer and G. rubra pink are the best indicators of sea surface temperature. Therefore, if a scientist is going into a core sample, they should study the species G. sucullifer and G. rubra pink to get good data for sea surface temperature. Thank you very much.